Hello, thank you for keeping it urban. My name is Nicholas Wasanja. Today on The Checkpoint, we are hosting Lieutenant General Charles Anyina, the Deputy Chief Coordinator, Operation Wealth Creation. Our topic tonight is we are going to be discussing enhancing agricultural production, especially during these trying times of COVID-19. General, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Nicholas, and thank you, the viewers.
General, how are you holding up during these times?
Yeah, it is a challenging time of COVID-19 because none of us knew this was going to be coming. What we understood in the Ministry of Defense then, that 10-15 years when we did our review, defense review, we knew that we are shifting from the strategic war fighting of the military mechanism of guns, bullets, bombs, warheads, to non-military conventional wars. And this is what is now coming, and it has come earlier than we had expected. Now we see our war is shifting towards poverty, towards locusts, fall armyworm, towards now COVID-19, which is a different ball game from the way we were trained initially in the defense of the country. But that comes, we should be flexible enough to adjust our human resource and available other resources to plug in and ensure we come in the defense of the people. Just like President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni, our commander-in-chief, in 2013, started to shift our focus under the leadership of General Salim Saleh to start poverty eradication and Operation Waste Creation. So you can see that that was a total paradigm shift. But the impact is now being felt, and now we have been called to put our efforts in support of Ministry of Agriculture and combating the locusts. On OWC, we have been fighting the fall armyworm under the Ministry of Agriculture also. And now the Ministry of Health is leading on COVID-19, but we believe COVID-19 has been adequately handled, and we salute the Ministry of Health and the team working at that national level and extensively linking up with the regional task forces. But we believe, under the leadership of President Yoweri Museveni, that we should not only focus on the aspect of health, we should also focus on the aspect of food security. Because medically, you need nutrition in order to create your immunity and the strength to deal with the attack of the virus. So we are making our efforts be clearly seen in the efforts of ensuring there is sufficient food security to sustain the country under this lockdown.
General, indeed, OWC is a household name. But one would wonder, in depth, what exactly is OWC and what informed its establishment?
OWC, I'm happy to get a feedback from you, Nicholas, that it is a household name. But OWC came into existence when President Yoweri Museveni was doing his field trips. And he went to Luwero and Rwenzori, his former fighters of the FRONASA who are still surviving. Most of them come from that region of Rwenzori and Luwero. So in his field trip in 2013, they were able to appreciate him for the great effort he has done in transforming the country, in transforming the economy, transforming the education sector, doing very well in infrastructure development. But they challenged him in one area, which they clearly pointed to him that they are really doing badly in terms of household income. So they told him, sir, if you can do something in that area, then for us, your fellow veterans, will feel happy in our retirement. So he chose to pick his own brother, General Salim Saleh, to lead that presidential initiative. And he also picked our most decorated, gallant female soldier, Nalweso, General Nalweso, Lieutenant General Nalweso, to join and become the deputy to General Saleh to start that initiative. So they moved in and asked then the Chief of Defense Forces, General Katumba Wamala, whom I was deputizing at that time, to give them some senior officers. And they were given 53 senior officers who went and did that pilot initiative in Luera and Rwenzori sub-region, and they were able to be very successful. So out of their success, the members of parliament from those regions were able to share with other members of parliament how those people were transformed within 1 year. That's two-season engagement. After the two-season engagement, they were able to ask the president, as members of parliament, that why don't you do us a favor and have this program roll the entire country? Because we also have so many veterans who are also very poor in regards to household income. So that's when the president now was able to consider it being rolled the entire country. So OWC, right now as we speak, it is an intervening effort, presidential initiative effort, to ensure that each household earns at least 20 million per year annually. So to achieve that one, you must cut it down to monthly. How much should somebody earn monthly in order to translate to 20 million? And that's 1.6 million per month. So we found that the entire country, there are only 32% of our population who earn the 20 million, which is 1.6 per month. But 68% of our population are not in that money economy. So our effort is to ensure that we create structures from constituency level, which is where a member of parliament comes from, up to the national level, to ensure that we begin with each of those households putting our efforts in agriculture as the backbone of quick transformation, because agriculture gives on farm employment and off farm employment, and we were moving quite well in bringing this transformation and the different challenges. But now when we were shifting from dealing with the household into dealing with a primary society, bringing households together in order to form the first unit of households coming together, in order to begin to look at how we can commercialize this agriculture, how they can share the facilities that government will give in order to have a bigger productive venture, and also in order to add value on whatever they produce. So we had started now formation of primary society. And in formation of our primary society, we're looking at governance as very critical. One aspect of the governance was that we would want to have a two-model approach, the rural-based model and urban-based model. The rural-based model, we are saying, can we have a group that constitutes itself from 61 members and above, and governed with 26 members for governance committees? That is 9 members in a management committee, 7 members in a supervision committee, then 5 members in finance and investment committee, and then 5 members in technical committee. Why those numbers? We picked 9 members, for instance, if we are to get government to give that particular primary society attractor. Out of the 9 members, there will be 3 who will be dedicated to see that the tractor is not used as a bulldozer, as an earth mover, but as a tractor which will go on a prepared garden, so that you don't break the tractor on the first day of it going into its operation. Then they will also ensure that all their members prepare the gardens in time, then their gardens are plowed. But most of the time you will find that maybe the 61 members and above, their gardens can be completed before the season runs out. So instead of having the tractor parked there up till the next season, they would go to other people who can hire their tractor. But in hiring their tractor, they should not also risk it just to send the tractor to go and work on those gardens. They must go and inspect. So these 9 members, they will be those ones inspecting, they are those ones doing the management at the center and ensuring that everything moves well. That's why we picked on the 9 members. While the supervision committee of 7 members for role of best is that we acknowledge that people retire. Even me, I'll retire. So when we retire, we are with our community. The community must make use of our experience to supervise and ensure there's effective returns in that investment. Then the other 5 member committee are cherry-picked, people whom they know are good in finance management, so that they don't mismanage the primary society's resources. And that's where there's always been failures in circles and groups, because they put all their investment and trust in one individual whom they call a treasurer. So we don't want a company of a treasurer at this level. We want them grounded using committees. So the Finance and Investment Committee will chew the issue of resources getting lost and also misinvestment. That's why it's finance and investment. We completely acknowledge that the issue of a treasurer has been a problem even historically. During the good governance of Jesus Christ, the treasurer who caused the problem was Judas Iscariot. He did not only steal the money, he even sold Jesus for money. So we do not want to take that path, with due respect to many treasurers that are there. Then we said a technical committee of 5 members, we do not want them to say, Wasaja, because you are from Royal, so your brother was a driver of the other truck, or the other lorry, can now come and operate a tractor. These are different machines. The other one is driven, this is operated. So we want a technical committee who will be able to quantify that this person can manage. So if we bring machines for value addition for this group, we would want it to be managed, maintained, and sustained by technical people.
So, Geno, could you say the target of 20 million annually for the 40% that is outside the money economy, have you been able to achieve this target 5 years down the road?
We have not absolutely achieved it, but we have progressively made some achievement. The 68% was coming down. We have had some challenges, like alluded to in the beginning, when we are moving at a point where we know we are bringing the 68% maybe to about 58, you find you get an attack of foliar armyworm. So that one will certainly have an effect. Then you have floods, then you have drought. And up to this point, our agriculture is still a rain-fed agriculture. We have not yet achieved irrigation aspect, which is part of our plan to bring real paradigm shift so that we don't rely only on rain-fed agriculture. This country is endowed and blessed with a lot of water bodies. And it's only how deep do you go where you don't have water bodies, you will still get water. And we'll be able to do very effective irrigation, both gravitation irrigation, a deep well irrigation, overhead irrigation from the water bodies nearby. We are moving that direction and we shall achieve it. COVID-19, before I come to COVID-19, the other model which I thought I should just briefly bring to the second model is urban-based model. The urban-based model is the model whereby we have 41 and above members. You remember that on a 61 members and above, and the governance is 26. But this one is 41 members and above, and the governance is 18. Why 18? We are saying that where there was 9 members for management, there will be 7. Where there were 7 members for supervision, there will be 5. Where there were 5 members for finance and investment, there will be 3. And where there were 5 members for technical, there will be 3. And that is 18 versus 41 and above. That's for per-urban farming and urban committees, I mean urban groups forming the primary society. That is how the two models are supposed to work. So COVID-19 has come even to make our challenge bigger. But we want to turn that challenge into an opportunity. Why? When you have all these members of the school going students at home, then it means we have a lot of workforce at home. So we want to use that workforce to work on the land, to plow the land, to produce adequately. So recently we did a survey as OWC to find out how many of the farmers have not been able to access inputs, but have prepared their gardens. And I want to give this information to the nation that majority of the farmers were able to access inputs and have planted. There's very serious harvest expected because farmers have done very well in utilizing that workforce. But those ones who did not get the seedlings because of the lockdown, because of whatever circumstance, those ones we are going to give them inputs, targeted inputs to particular farmers who are ready.
In real terms, what is the progress? Because apparently, with the COVID-19 scare, it seems like everyone is moving around with a begging bowl. What happened to the inputs that you supplied? We thought by now everyone would be food stable, but it seems COVID has shaken the table and there is no food for people.
No, there are about 3 factors that has caused that instability. One is that there has been a number of rural urban immigration. So people left their farmland and came to town for other opportunities. This lockdown has found them when they are not stable, so they are vulnerable. So that vulnerable group that are in the city is the one the president and the cabinet decided that they must be fed. So in feeding them, there has also been a challenge. The challenge that came, which is the second component, was that as soon as this opportunity came, the Prime Minister's office decided to engage the groups that we know are the big suppliers. I may wish to call them the big boys and the big girls. They are the ones who were called upon to supply the Mandela, the Flokai, the Aponyes, the Meta, and others to supply in order to give these people the food. But unfortunately, there was a problem in terms of quality of the products that they supplied, and also in terms of the pricing. And that caused the arrests that were done in Prime Minister's office. So that created instability and delayed an effective role of this food reaching out to the vulnerable. So that's one component. And when that happened, Prime Minister's office was able to call on WC, can you step in and reach out other suppliers who are not part of the big boys and big girls in order for them to be able to augment the efforts of distribution. So that's how we came in. And when we came in, unfortunately, the parliament passed the supplementary on the 9th of April, and that was on the Thursday. Then 10th was the Good Friday, and for that reason, you could not even be able to access the banks on a Good Friday, neither would you access them on a Sunday, or Saturday or Sunday, even on a Monday was Easter Monday. So it was all public all day. So there was a serious delay and time lost for OWC to begin running around persuading the farmers to give whatever they have on credit, trusting that we would stand in to ensure they get paid. So that caused that bit of delay. But all in all, the operation has continued very well and it has picked up. Part of the efforts now is in Wakiso and Mukono. So I would say it's been a very successful operation.
General, as OWC, do you have any plan to ensure that in future, probably we do not have this group of vulnerability? Because initially you talked about the rural areas, planning for the rural areas and the urban areas in your mandate. So do you, in future, do you have any plans to ensure that this kind of vulnerable groups do not reoccur when we have such a pandemic?
Yes, we had made a very comprehensive plan to ensure that ends. And for that, we had come up with a good write-up, which eventually, a write-up which went to cabinet and it was passed. And that write-up was a presidential initiative document called AgriLED. AgriLED meant what? It meant that the agriculture that we intend to engage in must be agriculture that attracts an industry. For every community, whatever you are producing must attract an industry. Even if it's a level of cottage industry, you must add value so that eventually you grow from a cottage industry into a mega industry. And you also grow from a small primary society to a secondary society and ultimately into a cooperative society. For AgriLED to succeed, it required us to organize the farmers, bring their mindset to leave the issue of working in silos, everybody for yourself, God for us all in your homes, but come and work together so that you can attract an industry. So that was the issue of agri component. But then there's the LED component. The LED component is that you cannot expect everybody to come out of poverty from agriculture. There are those ones who will come out of poverty by doing other local economic development. For instance, there are so many other opportunities that come with tourism and tourism-related industries. There are so many opportunities that come with minerals and mineral resources and its industries. There are so many opportunities that come with the service sector, which we have not tapped into. And this country is so much endowed with mineral resources. So when we get to know that where you are, your land is so fragmented that it does not make sense in the commercialization aspect, then we look at what other led opportunities are there, the local economic development opportunities which are there. So we change your thinking and make you tap into the opportunity that is available locally in your area. Then government would only do the infrastructure to support the led investment opportunities. So that is the document which went to the cabinet and it was passed overwhelmingly, and we had already started that program. If you followed up early this year, we had an expo which was called the Kasese Investment Expo, which was commissioned and flagged off by the president, and that was the first one. We had now warmed up to move to Busoga, which was the next, and move to Masaka and then other places. All this was going to bring a lot of opportunities, employment, and engagement, which would certainly not look at agriculture alone, but look at other local economic development. And that will still be able to be achieved as soon as we remove the lockdown on COVID-19.
General, you point at the issue of silos. They say we were not here, some of us, but at some point in time, this country had silos for food storage and reserves. 35 years down the road, they are empty. Do you have a plan as OWC to ensure that we have a food reserve as a country so that we don't fall on such hard times in future?
The plan is there, and the government has already engaged the Britons to put those stores. There's a big company from Britain which government has engaged, and they will put the stores in different strategic areas. It is called the Alva Blanche, which is going to be able to work on already strategic stores that have been put there by both private sector and also public sector. The private sector, the biggest investors in these silos has been the TGCU, the Grain Council of Uganda. They have done a commendable job, and I salute them. They have stores in different places, in Kasese, Kamwenge, this place of Kiriandongo, in the northern part of Nwoya and different parts of Uganda. They put strategic stores. And we have also put other stores under World Food Program, NADS. There are stores which could be able to evacuate and farmers don't get stuck with a lot of bumper harvest. There's also other stores that the Prime Minister's office was able to establish under different programs for the northern Uganda. So I believe for the current demand, whereby most of what we produce, we don't consume, we export, because there's no reason for you to store when our fraternal brothers in the region are demanding for something. So you have to cover them under the Pan-African spirit and many other conditions that brings us together. You must trade with them. So for reserves of government, it has already been passed as a policy, and there's resources already, and the investor who's going to do the stores, the company which is going to do the stores has been identified, Alva Blanche. So I believe we are moving in the right direction.
We are going for a very short break, but when we return, the general is going to tell us what criteria can one follow to access services of the Operation Wealth Creation, and when they access those services, how they can they capitalize them to ensure that they don't fall under the bracket of vulnerability in future when such a pandemic breaks. Welcome back from that break. Thank you for keeping it urban. Today at the checkpoint, we are hosting Lieutenant General Charles Angina, the Deputy Chief Coordinator, Operation Wealth Creation. And we are still assessing the viability, or how can we enhance agricultural productivity during hard times. General, how can a Ugandan access your services, and how can they utilize those services to get themselves out of the bracket of vulnerability, regardless of where they are, whether rural or urban areas?
The first critical requirement is for you to register. You register with your leadership. Initially, when we were doing our program, we were going house to house. That was household intervention effort. But now we are saying, can you come together as households and constitute, if you're in urban, 41 members, and then put up your governance committee of 18 members? If you're in urban, can we have 7 members in your management committee? Can we have 5 members in your supervision committee? Can we have 3 members of your finance and investment committee and 3 members of your technical committee? Then we know you are prepared. Then give us the enterprise that you think you are going to undertake, and then we cross-check and find really you are prepared. Then we would only deal with you on the issues of psychological mindset change, for you to be able not to come together for purpose of convenience, because the people come together in order to access whatever inputs we are going to give. Then after they've got it, they sell it and divide the resources and everybody goes in their own way. No, we want to confirm that you are really prepared to go that direction. Then we can work together to ensure you achieve your dream and there will be returns in that investment. If you are in urban, you still now be able to choose the enterprise and constitute 61 members and above, and then have the governance of 26. 9 members of management, 7 of supervision, 5 of finance and investment, and 5 of technical. Then we'd work with you. And we believe we'll work with you and your mindset is really set to achieve your dream, then we believe we can grow with you from primary society, secondary society, into a cooperative society. If you become a cooperative society, then we are very comfortable eventually that we have consolidated you into a cooperative society. We can now effectively hand you over to the Minister of Cooperative. If you are cooperated as industrialists who started small with the cottage industry, now you have grown into a proper cooperative industry, then we hand you to the Minister of Industry. You're following me? But with the value chain, you will find some of the people will be off takers of whatever products coming out of what we have produced from the farm into processing, into packaging, into marketing. We will be able to form up traders. Those traders will become a cooperative of traders. And that cooperative of traders, we shall also hand you over to the means of trade. So our assignment, our mission is to start with you from household, but work with you up till you become a cooperative entity. And then we hand you over in our first phase of our operation, because our operation has 4 phases. The initial phase was to deal with household. The second phase is to deal with the primary society. The third phase is to consolidate you into a cooperative society. The fourth phase, we shall hand you over to government framework, where now we know you are an entity that can now be properly regulated and supervised by government.
But General, there have been complaints that there is selective distribution of your inputs to people. How are you dealing with this question?
Well, there's nothing perfect that man does. You continue to improve. If there are complaints, we register those complaints and then we see how to plug them in. But our intentions was not to have any politics or any selection. We treat all Ugandans in the same way. We don't have the issues of affiliation. Are you affiliated to this party? Are you affiliated to this? So and so, no. All Ugandans who are under 68%, who are not in man economy, it's our duty to ensure you go and mainstream into man economy.
Is it possible for individuals that you've assisted or given support to be able to transform this support into general community growth?
Yes, and there's a number of those ones who have successfully succeeded, and there are those ones whom we have already channeled their request to NADS to begin planning and processing on how they can be able to access value additional equipment or productive equipment like tractors and then processing equipment. That's the direction we are taking. And when we are talking of agri-led under a means of local government, we are believing that the led component will also be able to train and retool and facilitate those ones who are not in agriculture. So there's nobody who's going to be left out.
How far have you gone as an institution with the implementation of the regional logistics hub and then the e-voucher system as requested for by General Salim Saleh?
So for the issue of the logistic hubs, it is working in line with these issues of farmers groups. When you form farmers group and then you begin to know that they are now aggregating themselves in a given area, their production level has gone up, you now need to give them farmer service centers and logistic hubs. And that makes us to deal with all the post-harvest losses, because when farmers begin to produce and they're not organized, then they don't have where to put their outputs, which is the logistic hub, which will receive whatever they've produced. While we are trying to establish farm service centers, so that when we have that, then we can now introduce the e-voucher system, so that we don't give them cash, we don't give them inputs, but we give them a voucher. Then they go to those farm service center and be able to pick their inputs just on time. You will agree with me that the rain pattern has continued to change. You may find we are here, but it's already raining in Kawempe. So the people of Kawempe, farmers, would be able to go to their center and be able to use their voucher to access the inputs. But if we buy them in general, then you find that I deliver to the place where it has not rained, and maybe it even rained after 2 months. Other places it arrives on time, other places it doesn't. So e-voucher will ensure all that. You only go to access when you know it's time for you to plant, because you have prepared the gardens and the rain is falling for your area. Then you go and access.
But how will this e-voucher system work, considering that the biggest chunk of your clientele are rural-based people that probably are not apt enough with technological advancement and they're a bit rudimentary, so you need to go along with them step by step. So how will it work then?
It's not that complicated. So long as you have any kind of phone which can receive a text message, you will be able to manage the e-voucher card. And then when you go to the center, the farmer service center and the logistic hub, there will be a card reader, just like a wallet card. So when you reach there, it will be able to identify the farmers who are entailed to receive only particular products for that area. And then it will be swapped and you pick whatever against the money they've put on your card. You can only not use that card to get money back in terms of cash. You cannot use it to buy other products that are not tailored for your e-voucher cards, because each of them will be made in line with the ecological zone. If you're in cattle corridor, it will be products to do with cattle. If you are in agriculture sector, which is non-animal, you will also be able. If you are in an area for horticulture, it will serve for that particular area.
Won't this system be abused, because our community has been riddled by corruption, and we've had stories of ghost suppliers within the system. So won't this e-voucher system be abused?
This is even going to cure more problems than we are facing, where we are doing it manually. So this is easier to trace. And also, once you swap and do an activity, we can read it at the center. Then we can quickly be able to make a follow-up. But when it was delivering, had the staff, you deliver and the person puts under the veranda, the person does not plant, leaves, abandons under the tree. But now, because they know everything you take, it is traced to you and is traced to the supplier. The supplier knows that if I just compromise and give air, tomorrow they will be able to trace it to me. It has really come in time to cure a problem, not to create a problem.
General, what other challenges do you face as OWC?
The outstanding challenges we are facing as OWC, it is moving slower than we had wanted to move. We have been slowed down by a number of factors. One factor is that if we wanted to cover a bigger area according to the way we are structured, we have a superstructure to reach out every constituency in the country, we are slowed down because there's limitation on the budget. When the parliament sits, it is able to give us what they think they can give us. So we cannot move at our speed. The second challenge we have faced is that the weather pattern has not been very friendly. You find that most of the time, either there's too much excess water and it destroyed what we had already planted, or there will be drought. That's why I'm saying we are shifting from rain-fed agriculture to irrigation, so that you can regulate everything according to the way you have planned. Then the third one has been the serious problem of aflatoxin. Aflatoxin is a mismanagement of crop, and especially the cereal crop. And this has been unfortunate that our farmers have not yet understood how dangerous it is for them to mishandle their harvest. Immediately you pick any of your harvest, say maize, say beans, say granites, and you put it on the ground, on bare ground, you will have immediately downgraded that particular product from grade 1 to grade 2. But most of our farmers believe if you put it on the tarmac road where there is less traffic, then you are putting it in a better place. But there's a lot of aflatoxin on the ground. There's dust that the vehicles move with, and mud. Eventually, you are contaminating that product. The second aspect is that when farmers realize that people have begun to steal their maize, for instance, in the garden, they will prematurely harvest it before it dries properly to leave the moisturization level that is acceptable in maize. So you find that maize getting contaminated, and eventually it becomes a recipe for aflatoxin. Also, when you are thrashing the maize, you should thrash it in a way that you don't break the maize. But you see how people put maize cobs in a bag, then they begin pounding. At the end of it, they crack it. When you crack it, that is an access for aflatoxin. Also, when you are storing it, if it is dry, you store it, you must dry it where there's enough window, there's enough aeration, so that that maize can dry without attracting a coldness or any condition that can cause molds. Once a mold comes, that is an exhibition that aflatoxin has taken center stage. And aflatoxin is very harmful to human consumption, even to the animals. For instance, if you hear so many young people, children, suffering from liver-related cancer, it is a result of eating contaminated food which has aflatoxin. The research has proven that women from the East, North, and West Nile sub-region have passed aflatoxin to their babies through breastfeeding because of eating too much of granites. And granites is said to have the highest level of aflatoxin, up to about 400 parts per billion. So for us to be able to get out of that challenge, even recently when they gave us to support Prime Minister's office with the supply of portioned beans, we found that most of the maize the farmers were giving had aflatoxin, and certain levels were not acceptable by Bureaus of Standards, UNBS. So I want the farmers to know that the best way you can do, if you can't keep your maize in the garden, when you harvest it with it, with its protector, keep it up till it properly dries. Then when you are to sell it, when it's properly dry, that's when you remove the peeling, you will have protected that maize. If you harvest cassava, whatever, don't put it on the ground, put it on a tarpaulin, so that you don't make it come in direct contact with the soil, to avoid aflatoxin. And then there, we shall have dealt with quality and also food safety.
Food safety. General, you post-harvest handling seems to be a big challenge, as you've expounded. But doesn't this beg the question of absence of extension services? Because OWC has been criticized for putting the cart before the horse, that you give people farm inputs without necessarily giving them the knowledge and information that they require to handle these inputs from the stage of harvest to from the stage of planting to harvest.
No, that is not correct. The correct position is that the means of agriculture continue to play their role. We only came in to augment. We did not come to take over the role of means of agriculture. And Ministry of Agriculture has a whole directorate of extension services. And it recruited over 3,030 staff. And they're still recruiting even more of extension services. The only challenges the extension services had was being mobile. They were recruited, but they did not have the mobility. But I salute the Minister of Agriculture and the Cabinet. They were able to procure for them some pickups and some motorcycles. So their mobility is now at least assured that they can be able to do some extension services. We came in to bridge the gap where initially people would be given support by the president, but it will not reach. That's why in our arrangement, they make sure that you must be a local from the same area. If you are from Bushenyi, it will be an officer of UPDF from Bushenyi who will be a constituency coordinator from the same constituency. So you cannot now cheat your people. They will come after you. If you are from the district coordinator, you must be from that district. If you're a regional coordinator, you must from that region. So that's how WC is formed. So there's no way we can now begin to say OWC came to take over the issues of extension service. We have put a cart before the horse before the cart. That is not correct. The position we came to fill in that gap, which initially NADS had failed, they could not be able to make things reach. And then they could not properly account. So the president picked some element of cadres and put them on the NADS to handle the issue of procurement, to handle the issue of contracts. For us, we do the deliveries. They do the issues of procurement, contracts. For us, we get the demand, pass it to them, then they do the procurement.
You seem to be throwing the ball at Ministry of Finance, but then one would wonder, then what is your collaboration between, what is the collaboration between OWC and NADS?
Poverty is a very bad enemy. When people get poor to the point that they cannot sustain themselves, they cannot have any kind of income, then why did we put our life on the line? Who went to the front line, who fought and liberated these people, do we leave them to die in poverty? The answer is no. We must come to help them get out of poverty. And that one we promise and we pledge that we shall get them out of poverty. Two, now the COVID attack, it's a viral attack. But you can see that the military are the ones who are in the front line to ensure that food reaches the vulnerable. Initially, we are the ones ensuring that they get the inputs in order to have food and in order to have income. Now, at the end of it, now it is what we are given, we are now outputting it and it's coming back to the people to save them again. Now, of recent, you heard there was a very serious attack by desert locusts who are in the lead. It's still the military who are ensuring they're fighting the locusts. We were fighting the fall armyworm. With the Minister of Agriculture, we're in the front line. So if you look at us just as military, we should keep at the frontier to wait for attacks from Al-Qaeda, ADF, and other terrorist group. You may not effectively make use of us. We are available. Even in disaster, Minister of Disaster gets into a problem. Then you find they're overwhelmed. They will call upon the military to come in and we intervene to help.
General, well said, but one would wonder, OWC wasn't created or established out of a law, but rather the goodwill of His Excellency the President. Doesn't this, in a way, impede the operations?
Not at all. It doesn't. It is only those ones who want to look at law as better than logic. But I would prefer that we look at logic better than the way we look at law. Because if law was perfect, why are we continuing to amend the law all the time? So we must look at what makes us do better. If the law is going to enslave us, then it's not a good law. But if law is going to make us be properly regulated, like you see in a football match, you need some regulation in order to have discipline and order. But if that is going to make the game fail to be played, all the time the ref is blowing the whistle, then the game will not be played. So that is what I'm saying, that we are going to ensure that where we find that we cannot be helped at all and everything requires the law to be put in place, then they will put it. But it will not stop us from doing what the president has told us to do, because people believe that we do not have legal wings or legal mandate. That one will come with the time. But before it comes, we work under the framework of the Ministry of Defense, that we shall be able to support the civil government, and we are subordinated to civil authority. So if civil authority says, come and help, we move in and help. But that does not make us remain domiciled doing the same thing. Once that intervention ends, like I said, this operation is four-phased. I told you, those ones who graduate, we hand them over to the mandated ministry. But we have done the grounding and picking people from where they are vulnerable to where they are now able to stand on their own.
There have been stories in the media that sometimes distribution of, say, cows, there are cows that were distributed that were on family planning. How do you ensure that there is quality distribution of farm inputs?
That one will now be chewed with Farm Service Center, because initially the procurement which was being done by NADS, they go to the supplier, and the supplier, of course, may want to make a maximum profit, and they pick the animals that are not in calf. But to us, when they give us, we go and tell the beneficiary, your cow is in calf, after 9 months you are going to have a calf and you will have milk and so forth. Then it doesn't come. Of course, we take the blame because we are the ones who handed over. But we don't do the procurement. The procurement is done by NADS, but eventually we take the blame. But that said, we believe that Farm Service Center will now be able to trace even the supplier that will have sold the animal, because it's in the same region. They will have to remove whatever is meant for that region and position that region. So they will be holding grounds. They will be able to know this animal has issues before it goes to the beneficiary.
But Geno, one of the debates has been the president time and again talks about being able, self-contained, and being able as a country to produce so for export. But in most cases, when Ugandans lobby for such deals, say produce pineapples of this quantity, of this size, one week, 2 days down the road, they're out of supply. Where's the missing link? Because yet in other countries that are probably a bit weak in security and all that, seem to be doing well, and they are exporting on the global scale, but Uganda seems to be lagging behind. Where's the missing link?
Yeah, the missing link is that everybody has been doing it on their own. Everybody for himself, God for us all. OWC is trying to chew that by forming primary society, secondary society, so that they're able to produce what is sustainable to any market. But when you do it individually, you choose the priority of your family. It is not market-driven, but individual benefit-driven. But now we are putting them together and say, pick a product that you would add value. Pick a product that we can sell to a market that we can identify for you. So when they choose, we work with them and ensure they produce sustainably and feed the market required. And that one, I believe, we have identified the problem, we're halfway solving it.
Don't you think the issue of cooperatives will come in handy in trying to cover that gap?
That's what I'm saying. We are beginning with the primary society, then eventually become secondary society. When we aggregate secondary society, it becomes a cooperative society. But these are well-grounded moves together with us. Then they become a cooperative society. Now they will be able to produce in large scale, and they can sustain whatever market that will be there. And we'll ensure that we add value, at least primary processing for anything. If it's animal, Can we sell them beef, well-processed beef? Can we retain the skin and hides and process them into leather bags, into shoes, and so forth, so that they're self-sustaining and no job export by selling a raw product?
Okay. Now that the rains are here, how are you preparing your clientele to ensure that we have enough harvest post COVID-19? Because it seems like so much food has been consumed during this period, and so we might there might be a reoccurrence of famine if we do not take advantage of this period.
Yeah, that's a very good concern. I was saying, as we salute the Ministry of Health and the national team that are dealing with COVID-19, we have also been with Ministry of Agriculture working on the issue of food security. And the survey has confirmed that because of the lockdown, so many students have been working very hard, and we're happy that they have been very productive wherever they have been. So most gardens have been planted. However, there were a few other farmers who were not able to access the inputs. And those ones who have tabulated them, we know their parishes, we know their names, we know how many acreage. But I will suffice to say, if we find you have 5 acres of land that you are prepared, we shall not give you, because we know you would have prepared 4 acres and used the money that you have spent in preparing more acreage in buying inputs. So for you, maybe you are planning for the second season, season B, so you don't take advantage of these inputs. We have only targeted those ones of 4 acres and below. And we are not looking at only our Ugandans, even refugees who are living in the community. We have covered all of them. So EDNADS has been given instruction to engage the pre-qualified seed suppliers, USTA, Uganda Seed Traders Association, to quickly ensure that these inputs reach the parish of those ones who have prepared the gardens but they did not have the inputs. That one, it's already been communicated.
Already underway.
Yeah.
Do you have any plans for urban centers under this kind of preparation?
Yes, if we get to know that there are people who are doing urban farming and they lack inputs, we shall be able to provide them. But we're very considerate of the regions that the rainfall may not be good for them, given the short remaining window. So we said the entire country, we are giving them inputs of horticulture nature. People must eat vegetables throughout. Those ones, we have no limit to every region. But when you look at Eastern, Northern, and West Nile, they still have rain. And we have also left out certain inputs that we know may not work at this remaining window of planting. And we have left out maize, we have left out beans, we have left out soya beans, we have left out sorghum. Because those ones, unless we had the inputs which we call drought resistant. But since we checked with the USTA, the Uganda Seed Traders Association, we found that they do not have a drought resistant kind of inputs. So we left those ones out because we don't want to waste under the current conditions. Every coin matters. So we believe for vegetable, the whole country will receive, but for those regions, they will receive these other inputs that can still be able to work within the remaining window of the rainfall. And we're already preparing adequately for season B, where we shall have robust distribution in the entire country.
Geno, as we are winding up, do you practice what you preach?
Yes, I do.
How?
I do poultry farming, I do dairy farming, I do goat keeping. I tried some fish farming, but I left it because of other reasons. I tried piggery, but I was hit squarely by African swine fever. At that time, I had parental stock of 410. The littered piglets were so many, but I lost all of it, and I said, I will only do that when I'm retired, because I will be able to. Yeah, I will be able to be there to ensure biosafety. But when you're not there, there's a lot of negligence and you can make very big losses.
General, your parting shot, especially on the question of food security for Uganda.
Yes, my parting shot, I want to thank you, all the viewers, and you who has been moderating, Nicholas Wasaja, for giving us opportunity to communicate to the nation. I would want the country to know, as we continue to appreciate God, that up to this point, God has protected us against loss on a human on COVID-19. And we pray that we shall lose nobody to COVID-19. I would want that we do not only suffer of the outcome of surviving COVID-19, then suffer famine. That will be very, very much unfortunate. It will be a tragedy. That's why under General Salim Saleh and the Honorable Minister Sempija, we have dug in to ensure people must have sufficient food. With all these attacks of locusts, or attack of polio armyworm, we do not want to give room to an available opportunity. Now we are looking at how much of our land that is productive and is not being put in use. We know that Uganda, we have 40 million arable land that is good for utilization, but we only have 17.2 million acreage, which is under production. 22.8 million acreage is not in production. So we want to use this window to ensure that we open all that land. We know that land falls under the category of institutional land. It is falling under the category of cultural land. Then there is land which falls under private land. And then there is land which has been hunting community land. But these days, there is no more hunting, because we have ensured that all those animals that would hunt are kept in game parks and animal reserves. So instead of that land remaining there idle, unless it is a grazing, community grazing land, that one we shall still restock and have animals in place. But land which was for hunting must be turned into productive agricultural land, so that we can be able to produce enough, attract industries, process them, and have what we would call import substitution. We have been importing a number of products from agriculture. We import cornflakes, and yet we can do cornflakes here. We have been importing Cerelac and all these baby foods, which we can process here. If you see dairy products and it is in taste, most of it we import when we can process it here. So we want to add value and order to achieve what we dream to achieve, which is agri-led. Agriculture for industrialization. Then other people who have got their land so fragmented that they cannot make sense of agriculture out of it, we shall see other local economic opportunities that we can do for their development.
Indeed, agriculture for industrialization is a comparative advantage for Uganda. General, we don't take it for granted that you've made time for the show. Be sure to catch Checkpoint tomorrow.